Fireside Chat Podcast, Episode 6, My Kingdom for a Center, recorded February 26, 2013.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat, featuring Dan, Matt, and Lucas.
And we're back. How's everyone feeling tonight?
Well, would have been more happy with a two-point effort from the Flames tonight.
I feel like I just watched a game between the Flames and the Wild.
Yeah, same thing.
You know, after those two games on the weekend, I was optimistic about coming into this game and the effort the team would give us. And I guess I shouldn't have been, because it was a game against Minnesota, but I was really disappointed. At least we got 1 point
out of it. Hey, you know. They are what they are. And we don't play Minnesota well, for whatever reason.
It's very true.
We don't win against them as much as I feel we should. And yeah, I'm saying it, screw it. I'm helping.
I was going to say, I think the biggest glaring hole on this team is down the middle for the forwards with the centers. And it's no secret. I mean, everyone's talking about it. We've talked about it. The Suns talked about it. Fan960's talked about it. What are your guys' thoughts?
We don't have any. That's what it comes down to. I mean, it's one thing to have centers that aren't particularly good or necessarily up to the challenge. It's quite another to be in the situation the Flames are, where they have one natural centerman on the roster, like Stajan. And as we discussed last week, there's way more to be in a center than just taking the faceoffs, and the wingers don't have it in them to play the rest of that game.
Yeah, you know, the thing that I find interesting is that every center this team has that is, and let me preface this, not perhaps number one center quality, but at least a natural center with some NHL experience, Blair Jones, Paul Byron, Roman Horak, are all playing in the AHL. And why are they playing in the AHL when we have a glaring hole on this team? Let's bring those guys back up to fill those spots.
Well, with Paul Byron, I think he's still out with a broken hand, but it just doesn't really make a lot of sense why Jones and Horak are down at the moment. You saw tonight in the Wild game that like the Flames only won like 30% of the faceoffs. Now, every time you lose a faceoff, it takes at least 15 to 20 seconds to actually get the puck back, and your shift's only 30 to 40 seconds long, so you don't really have any opportunity to actually do anything once the play starts, and it gives up way too many chances for the opposition to come in and score. Just, you know, a very shoddy group of centers for the team right now.
And I don't know if there's a way for you to coach against this or account for the fact that you're going to lose most of your draws, but I don't know, maybe have your forwards, or at least two of them, cheat up or crash towards where the opposing centerman would be likely to win the draw anyway, and almost sort of concede that and just go right in on the attack. That might be one way to go about it, but I'm certainly not one to tell the coaching staff how to X's and O's this. But you've got to do something. Like, you can't spend 20 seconds a shift just chasing guys.
Yeah, you have to marginalize their advantage somehow.
And you know, to me, it's like, what? We shouldn't have to coach against it. Like, that's the frustrating thing is, you know, putting guys like Blake Como at center is just a stupid idea. And I'm going down this roster. I'm looking at the roster right now thinking there's not many guys left that haven't played center yet that we could possibly put at that position. Like, the only other guy seems to be Steve Bajen and Yari Hudler.
Might see McDonald take a couple of face-offs too, you know.
Maybe they'll bring the backup in just to play center. Put Danny Taylor at that position.
What we need to do is, what needs to happen is Cervenka needs to be fast-tracked to play center. He was brought in as a center. The team sorry. The team needs centers, and if you're not going to bring up your players from Abbotsford, and if you're going to insist on playing wingers out of position, the guys that, you know, are capable of playing center better, like Cervenka, need to learn on the fly. It's the only way they're not even going to say nothing of winning, just remaining competitive, because that the whole inability to have the puck off the draw and just spending the entire game chasing the other team over the course of a month or two, I'm sure is going to wear a team out.
Mm-hmm. Well, like the thing that really doesn't make any sense is that the Flames are more of a Detroit Red Wings style of puck possession kind of team. So it doubly doesn't make any sense why you're just giving the puck away for 20 seconds every faceoff.
And, like, have you noticed, I noticed, the best line tonight was still probably Cervenka, Hudler, and Berchi, but they would get, you know, their one chance about for about 10 seconds, and then they looked immediately gassed. They had nothing left to give by the end of running around after the puck.
You know, and I thought that Cervenka, Hudler, Horak was a good-looking line, and I liked Horak in the middle there. And when they sent him back down, I was really puzzled as to why, again, you'd send one of your natural centers who had chemistry with his line mates down. It's like this team doesn't want to have chemistry
with
their
lines. Maybe they're tanking. They probably aren't, but... Maybe they...
Those seem strange.
Well, that makes sense. I mean, that's the only thing I can think of as to why you'd play a team with no centerman on it.
It baffles me, too.
Could be an indication from the, you know, the hockey ops part of the organization to just convey the message that, look, the vets we can assemble aren't going to be able to bring us where we want. So we're probably going to have to tear this thing down. It might be. And this is all speculation. I don't have sources. Don't tweet me.
Yeah, to me, though, that seems like it might be a bad idea, because if you're trying to go into UFA to get centers, do you think as a centerman you're going to want to come here in
Depends
July?
Depends on how many dollars are on the paycheck.
True, but we got to find three
of them,
right?
The thing is that, like, with what we saw today with Ryder getting exchanged for Eric Cole, while neither of them are centers, you can do that where you're switching out a winger for a center in a trade. That you're not going to lose talent off the, you know, because some teams do have too many centers. So there's not really any excuse why we're magically running with one center since Backlund went down.
And I mean, you know, last week we talked about bringing centers in from UFA. And we've talked about trading defensemen that we might have too many. If we play armchair GM for a minute, realistically, who would you bring in a trade that's a centerman? Who do you think we could actually get, and what would we have to give up to bring them in?
The trade I would make is Mike Camilleri to Florida for Steven Weiss.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I kind of think Weiss is past his prime at this point.
Well, he's still a 50 to 60 point center. He's only 29, I think. And Florida, if I recall correctly, does have enough centers where they could swap one out for a winger. It wouldn't be like the ideal option. I'm not saying that Weiss is the be all and end all, but, you know, we do need
better
centers.
Than nothing.
Yeah.
If you could actually get Florida to bite on that, I'd do that trade in a heartbeat. I mean, that's Steven Weiss. I haven't watched him play more than 10 games in his entire life, but based on his reputation, I think he instantly becomes the best center the team has had since Lanko was in his prime.
He's a slightly better version of Stajan, but, you know, that's not necessarily a bad thing.
Well, it's sort
What's
it's
the
sort
cost
of
for
is,
Weiss?
You,
do you guys know?
I don't know what his cap number is or anything like that, but I mean, a slightly better version of the guy who has been public enemy number two behind Bomeister.
Well, Stajan has been good this year thus far.
He has so been. But
that's what I'm comparing him to, not like last year's, you know, let's wave right. this guy player, but yeah.
And you know, that's good to see that we can take those players. We've seen it from J-Bo too, having a much better year. And we can take those guys that we thought were just a waste of cap space and actually get something out of them.
Yeah, I just think that the market for good centers in the NHL is so... It would cost so much to bring even a moderately serviceable guy in. I don't see Florida moving Camilleri, or Weiss for Camilleri of all people. Just because they're, you know, more of a budget team. Kemmler makes, I'm sure he makes more money than Weiss. And,
yeah, actually, just
Weiss is under contract till this year, and he's making 3.1 this year.
Yeah, so
that's his cap hit.
Yeah, and so Camilleri's do another six after this year, you know.
Well, the thing is that they can actually add cap in trade now, so.
You can, but that wouldn't be a problem for Florida. The problem would actually be the money, right?
No, you actually, I do believe that you give money as well. It's not
you can.
Not just the cap. But I'm not sure. Right.
But wouldn't, like, if you're going to do that, like, you don't want to do it with too many different players, lest you run into, you almost paint yourself into a cap hell corner accidentally, because I'm sure that... you know, if they were going to do that with anyone, they'd probably want to do it with Bomeister, because if they do that, the return for him, you know, goes up, or potentially goes up that much more.
Well, you can send up to 15% of the total cap, which is about $10 million. So, yeah, you could do both. So.
So, I mean, like, Lucas, you were saying that the price for a center or an elite center is so much, and I agree, but what if you didn't bring in an elite center? I mean, what if we bring in a lower-level second, third, fourth line center just so we have at least one that we can then decide at the end of the year if we want to keep him or do something else? I'm thinking a guy like Marcel Gauck.
Well, you have to ask yourself, what are they actually going to do to change the fortunes of the team overall that your guys on the farm wouldn't do, I think. And I, as much as Marcel Gauch is a fine NHL player, the team needs, and the team needs somebody to come in and just take some face-offs, but nobody you could bring in, especially for what it would cost to acquire them, which I'm thinking would be at least some mid-level prospects, probably maybe a second-round pick, which... tired of trading those, as I'm sure everyone is it going to get you into the playoffs? I don't think so. It might get you from 13th to 10th, but what's the point in that?
Yeah, and I mean, I'm not saying that we can necessarily do this, but I always like to come back to the analogy of Curtis Glencross. I mean, when he came here, he was a free agent that we signed for next to nothing because the Flames saw something that nobody else did. So maybe there's a guy out there somewhere that, you know, we see something in that nobody else does, and he's got 2 years, and he could be a serviceable second-line center if given the right chance.
Well, sort of like Yuri Hudler, how he's come in and been a decent second-line option when he was mostly playing on the third line in Detroit. So, you know, maybe there's a center version of Hudler out there.
Cody Hodgson. I mean, that's no. I mean, he's a number one now, isn't he? He's playing with Panic.
Yeah.
Hodgson is.
Yeah. And he's actually performing rather well. It's looking like
that. I didn't even know that. Oh yeah, I guess he's got 17 points this year. So yeah, I guess he probably is number one there.
Yeah. Well, he allowed them to trade Derek Roy.
You know, if he wasn't overpaid, I'd almost say we should go after getting Steve Ott in a deal. But for the price that they're paying him, I don't want anything to do with him.
No.
Is Steve Ott a center?
Yeah.
okay. I'd love Steve Ott on this team. He was one of the reasons that, you know, Dallas is still, well, okay. He was one of the reasons that Dallas was my favorite team to watch play the Flames for the longest time. Even though, like, even now, Dallas is still, they always provide an entertaining matchup. But Steve Ott versus Ajula was...
the Sabres are paying Steve Ott $2.95 this year, and that's way more than I think he's worth. That's his cap hit. They're actually paying him $3.2 million.
Yeah. I'd take Steve Ott just for the energy he'd bring, the physical element, and if he can play center, so much the better. I mean, that is your sort of, I don't know if he's a
that's
Glenn
the kind
Cross
of guy
in the
we
middle,
need.
But yeah, like that. If you were going to go back to your Glenn Cross example, even though Steve Ott's more established, he's that level of player, that $2.5 to $3.5 million player who fills his role really effectively.
Yeah, because I know when he was a UFA, I was really hoping they were going to bring him in, and when I saw what he signed for, I thought, I don't really want to pay almost $3 million for Steve Ott here, but now it's looking like he might be the kind of guy that we really need at that price.
Who would you rather have, Brandon Prust at 2.5 or whatever he's got, or Steve Ott at 2.9?
Steve Ott, no question. I mean, if Brandon Prust comes back here, he'll end up getting traded again in 6 months anyways, so.
Exactly.
Matt, what do you think? Would Ott fit in well here?
Oh, I don't see why he wouldn't. You know, like, the Flames, they just need somebody. Like, I didn't think it's getting to the point of actually being desperate and needing a body, whether it's an energy guy or a more established guy.
Yeah, I'm cringing waiting for the day that they're going to try and get Conroy to come out of retirement just to play center here.
Either that or get Stefan Yell. At least he could win a face-off.
Where is he all these days?
Well, I think he hung him up with Carolina like 3 years ago.
You know, Steven Reinprecht, somebody sent me a note on Twitter that Steve Reinprecht is still a UFA. They're talking about former Flames who are UFAs. I'm surprised that guy's still around.
Yeah, he was in, I think, with Manitoba or wherever the Canucks farm team was last year. And he wasn't even standing out amongst the AHLers.
Wow.
Well, if you think about it, when you know you're not getting into the Hall of Fame, what's your incentive to actually retire? Like, retire in 5 or 6 years when it's very clear that nobody's coming calling, and you can just, you know, you can start collecting that pension or count down to collecting that pension. But you might as there's no incentive for him to really hurry and file his retirement papers.
I think when you get to that age, sometimes retirement just means nobody's signing you anymore.
Yeah,
but I mean, there's also just a formal declaration of it. Every now and then you see, like, things cross the wire where, like, oh, this, you know, random fourth liner retired, and it's like, good for
you. Okay.
Like, yeah, it's like when Brent Cron announced he was retiring, and I'm like, sure you are, buddy. Not by choice.
Well, that's it, yeah. Wasn't he, and when did he actually retire? I know last I had heard of Cron, he was still in the Dallas system.
I think like 2 years ago he hung him up.
Yeah, something like that.
I know it's not the best source, but I'm on Wikipedia and it just says that Brent Cron is an unsigned pro goalie. So maybe he's working in some other industry just hoping somebody's going to pick him up.
Who knows?
Oh, March 8th, 2011, it was announced he'd been left off the roster. So I guess he's been employed up to the 2010-2011 season.
Well, good on him.
That's surprising.
That was a waste of a draft pick.
He's played one NHL game.
You could say that pretty much of every pick since, like, 1988.
Rico Fatta, Dan Tkachuk.
Chuck Kobasu.
But at least some of those guys, I mean, whether with the Flames or not, actually got into the NHL.
I know, but, you know, when you're drafting in the top 10, you're expecting to get at least a second liner. You know, like Corey Stillman, like, he wasn't great, but
yeah,
you know, at least he was decent.
here's the thing. You know why teams who draft in the top half or in the bottom half of the top 10 always seem to be crap? Because all the good centers are gone by 5.
True.
Most of the time. So what is this telling us?
Don't be like Edmonton?
No, centers. Just
that's
take
always a
the
rule,
centers. If all else fails, like, just center. Best center available. If you drafted nothing but centers every draft, you'd be fine. You can find other defensemen or wingers or convert centers to wingers. But just... I would go so far as to say that if a player is a winger, you immediately discount him from your draft board.
Yeah.
And of course, that's ridiculous because...
Unless he is significantly better than the center option.
Yeah, but it's got to be significant. It's got to be like Como versus Drouin. Otherwise, just take
or
a center.
Like Berchi versus Mark McNeil or something like that.
Exactly.
So if 30 teams are trying to take centers with every pick, that means we have to have 270 centers in every draft.
It would be, but keep in mind, no other team is that crazy. Sometimes you have to be crazy like a fox.
What, like the Islanders taking all defensemen last draft?
Yeah, that was dumb. If they'd taken all centers, that could have been clever. But since you can only ever have 6 defensemen on an active roster at a time, or on a game roster at a time, what's the point?
Unless they think they can convert defensemen to wingers.
That would be a very Islander thing to do.
Wouldn't it, though? Wouldn't it, though?
Yeah. Smooth
skate. We'll just try. Actually, you know what would be a Gar Snow thing to do? Is to take 9 goalies and say we'll convert them to centers.
DiPietro.
Exactly. DiPietro, you're not worth a net anymore. Take the pads off. Go learn how to win a face-off. We're playing you tomorrow night.
I'd really like to see Rick DiPietro reinvent himself as, I don't know, an enforcer. If he just showed up, like,
that would
like,
be worth it.
He got tired. He got tired of being injured all the time, so he just went. He went to a Gold's gym, bought $50,000 worth of steroids, and just came to training camp a mini Hulk who didn't fit into any of his equipment, and just was whooping ass.
I remember a rumor out of the Islanders camp a couple years ago that Charles Wong was in Japan scouting sumo wrestlers to play in net.
That was true.
The Islanders, what do you do?
Move them to Brooklyn.
That's sell, the answer.
And sell the team.
Yeah, I think that's what's coming next. While we're on the topic of crazy, Matt, you said this week before the show came on you wanted to compare Curtis Glencross to Guy Lafleur.
Yeah.
Well, WTF, my friend.
His hair.
One of the things that I've noticed with Glencross is that he seems a little bit inconsistent when he's trying to play the part of an offensive player. And it reminded me of a story of Guy Lafleur. One, he never used to practice. And one time the coach told him to knock it off and let's practice how to play on the power play and all that. And that night, Guy Lafleur had his absolute worst game, and he never played it in practice again. Now, Curtis Glencross, when he's playing on instincts, he's very good, and like that's how he got the 25-26 goals last year. But, you know, when you can actually see it when he's trying to play more like Alex Tanguay, that, like, his decision-making's off, and you just can't seem to click it over to actually get it to work, and so that maybe he needs to just play on instinct instead of trying to force himself to be something he's not.
I just realized who you were describing, when you went through this, and it's not Guy Lafleur, it's Jerome McGinley. If you think about it, how many times have you seen McGinley go through these phases where he thinks, oh, I'm going to have to dangle my way through 5 people, score a highlight reel goal, and instead of just putting his head down, being a bull in a china shop, and crashing the net and getting the job done? I think honestly that's the recipe for success with any player. Like, you can't have them thinking the game is too fast, and that's why hockey sense is such a valuable commodity.
Yeah, like players can think the game, like Tanga, he can think the game and be successful at it. But others, they just need to rely on their talent.
Yeah, like, and Tanga, like, thinking the game is just, I don't think it has anything to do with, like, surveying the scenery and dissecting it or anything like that. I think it's just an awareness of how players are moving on the ice and the options that physically individual players have to react to what you do. And
scouts call that hockey sense.
Exactly. And if you're really good at interpreting that, then you're a good player. And when you start trying to do too much, like any coach will tell you, then this is when you stop being the consistent producer you were before, and you think you're Wayne Gretzky.
And I mean, we've seen some players who, I don't want to say subpar, but perhaps aren't as good as other guys on the roster, but can see the game better and have better hockey sense. And because of that, they're more valuable players because they can help other guys out. They're more useful on the ice in different scenarios. And so I think that, you know, when you are drafting and even as you're trading, you've got to look for that. That's one of those kind of weird mental factors that there's no stat for, but you've got to try to figure out who those guys are that have that hockey sense.
Well, one might actually argue that the stats themselves are indicative of hockey sense. I mean,
they can be.
Like that's the thing. Like at the NHL level, like you need a baseline of physical tools, and if you're a consistent point producer in the league, it's because you've got the hockey sense to do it, or you've got otherworldly talent like Ovechkin.
Yeah, at the same time, I'd say a guy like Jerome has hockey sense, but the stats aren't showing that.
Well, like if you look at Glenn Cross specifically, like his slap shot is in the same class as Ginla's, and you know, like he can pass. It's just when he seems to try to do too much instead of just playing within himself, he makes mental mistakes. And like tonight, he was downright dreadful turning the puck over left, right, and center because he's trying to pass the puck through like how Tanguay does, and it's just not his game.
Yeah, you're right. One thing I wanted to get opinions on is the Mitch Wall trade. The first trade of the season for the Flames, and as Flames fans, I know I was excited when I saw on my phone from TSN, Calgary Flames make a trade. Then I look at what the deal was, and it was two minor league guys. We traded Mitch Wall away, and I can't even pronounce the guy that we got's last name. Matt, I know you hit it earlier.
Tesweede.
So it was Mitch Wall for Tesweede, and he's, what, a 26-year-old AHL player who is undrafted, Mike Tesweede?
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Yeah, he's a free agent from the NCAA.
And we know how Feaster likes his U.S. college guys.
He sounds like a Pokemon. If you were walking through tall glass, a wild Tesweede would appear.
Well, perhaps the Flames need some of that.
Apparently he has a brother, too, that played for the Abbotsford Heat last year. So they obviously know the family name.
What happened with him? They evolved him with a Firestone?
Maybe that Tesweede got tamed, so they had to get a new wild Tesweede. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I don't know enough about this guy to even talk about him. He's 26, he's 6'3", 210 pounds, plays wing, so he's not even playing center. And
damn,
he was
it,
undrafted. They traded an ECHL centerman for an AHL right winger.
Well, he'll basically, if he ever does come up, he'll play the same kind of game as Akeem Alou, where he just crashes and bangs, and that's about it.
I hope he doesn't come up, though, because we should have enough guys that are in the depth chart before him.
Well, if we moved Como down and called him up, I think that would be a net positive just so we don't have Como anymore.
But Como's playing center. Who's going to play center?
Insert the name of anybody else.
They should just almost put their names in a hat and draw on the plane between games.
Just a point of order here. It's actually pronounced 17.
What is?
His name.
17?
Yeah.
Who in the world?
Where did you get that from?
Well, it's his jersey number. So I figure if the more we talk about him like he's not in the room, at a certain point he'll just take the hint and not be there.
Can I give you some bad news?
What?
He's wearing 41 in Abbotsford.
No, I think Como. He's talking about Como.
Como is pronounced Como. 17.
Okay.
And we shall not speak of him again.
We shall just call him 17 if we need to refer to him.
Just for future warning, anyone who speaks the name of Como, place the charm on it, and Death Eaters will appear at your location and try to kill you.
Now we have hired guns that are going to kill you if you say 17's name?
No, they're not hired. They're just wizards.
Okay. So we have wizards, and the best thing we have them do is killing people who mention him instead of trying to get this team to actually do something.
Well, they're wizards. They're not gods.
No, if they were gods, Edmonton would try to get them to fix them.
I don't think that's even possible.
I'm so lost.
We all are, but who cares?
We get lost every show.
So, in what situation would you take Jonathan Drouin this year?
Number one.
You've listened to not a word of my center diatribes, have you?
We've listened. We're trying to get you going.
Well, no, I know that, but you just said number one. Like, and how do you know?
Because he's performing a lot better than McKinnon.
No. I mean, how do? Hold on a sec. Let's reevaluate this. So you're saying Drouin's going to go number one, but we're still going to have a shot at McKinnon because we're not going to draft number one.
Yes.
Okay.
I think 1, 2, 3 is going to be Drouin, Jones, and then McKinnon.
Ugh, people are silly.
Even if we can't get McKinnon, Monahan's right there. He's not as good, but I'd still take him as a centerman.
Barkov is a centerman, isn't he?
Yeah. There's, I think, 4 or 5 decent centermen in the top 15, so...
Good. Get one of them. Get all of them. No, just one.
We don't have 15 picks.
We don't.
Well, if we trade off everybody, we might.
Lindholm's a decent center as well.
Barkov, so there's probably, bust.
5 that'll go in the top 15?
Well, plus we also got Jankowski, who's showing some skill in Providence, so...
Yep, that's one. We need at least 3.
We've got Stajan locked up for a few years.
Just one more after this, and then after he's gone, our organizational hole gets even bigger.
We'll figure it out down the road.
Hey, you're a winger? No, you're a center now.
That's the problem. That's why we are where we are.
I'd hate to be in some of those draft interviews. So you play left wing. Yeah, how do you feel about playing center? Get out. Bring in the next kid.
I honestly think it should be like, oh, so you're a left winger? Yeah. Goodbye.
You were a left winger.
No, this is the problem. Trying to convert people into something else. And that's where you out-clever yourself. Like, how do I explain this? I cannot remember if the Chiefs did this, but the Chiefs, I believe, used to have a long history of drafting safeties to play cornerback. And everyone was shocked, or nobody was shocked, when the safeties turned cornerbacks kept getting torched. So what we've got now is a team full of converted wingers playing center and Matt Stajan. And we're losing to the Wild. And outside of miracle games against Phoenix... We're losing to Phoenix. And
we're losing to pretty much everybody.
Exactly. And they're backups. We are losing to backups.
Yet somehow we managed to be at 500.
Hey, we're better than the Oilers. So that's always good.
That's all I care about. As long as we finish ahead of the Oilers.
At a certain point, when does being better than the Oilers become, oh, we're only the third fattest chick at the bar?
Well, hey, we're the third fattest. We're not the fattest, so it's all
good. I know, but you're still 100 pounds away from being anyone's fifth choice.
I'd rather be the third fattest than the fattest as well.
I'd rather be neither. Like, it's one of those things where it's like, okay, every day at work, I look at order sheets and I notice that the most requested product by far is Coke Zero. And that screams to me, we're all just fooling ourselves. If you want a Coke, have a Coke. Coke Zero doesn't taste better. It's full of just as much cancer-causing crap as regular Coke. And if you're that worried about the calories, maybe you should go for a walk instead of buying a Coke Zero.
You know, going back to the third fattest chick at the bar, when life throws you cookie dough, what can you do?
Go for a walk. And I understand that the cookie dough is not going to make him love you.
That's why she's the third fattest, because she walked to the bar and her friend didn't.
Yeah, because she realized she was going to have to get her own damn drink. No, you know you're not doing well when you're not even sure the waiter's going to come get you a drink. You've got to pick yourself up and wander across the bar.
Oh my god.
You can tell that there's not a lot to talk about with the Flames, can't you?
13th place team with one natural center.
And what a backup needs to, goalie.
Yeah, what more needs
two
to
backup
be said?
Goalies.
They're all backup goalies.
Speaking of the backup goalies, it looks like the Flames have picked McDonald over Taylor, which last week we said we would probably pick Danny Taylor. And, you know, to his credit, for what he is a backup goalie who has, 100 games under his belt, Joey McDonald hasn't looked that bad.
No, he's solidly in the 55 to 60 overall for goalies. You know, lower end backup. Not bad, not great.
I would say that he has made, in his last six games, about 10 to 20 of the most impressive saves a backup has made for this team in the last 3 years. And he's done
it
consistently.
He's also probably the most experienced backup this team's had in 3 years.
Oh, he is, for sure.
Besides Nabokov.
He's been able to get it done in a way that nobody else we've had has been able to do. So.
But no, I'm liking not every minute of every game with him, but overall I'm liking what I'm seeing from Joey McDonald. I think he's making a case to be the backup when Kipper comes back, which still looks like it's probably a week away.
For sure. And yes, we're completely backing off what we said last year, but as I also said last week, not last year, sports is about being reactionary.
It's true.
If you want to play the long game, try diplomacy.
And, you know, I think in the end, I mean, it makes sense to keep McDonald as your backup. We can say what we want about Danny Taylor, but McDonald has experience, too, and that's one thing we haven't seen in Flames backups in a while. It's like they're scared of those kind of guys. Danny Taylor has no NHL experience. He's got one game. So, to me, I always would probably err on the side of experience when it comes to a backup goaltender.
It makes you wonder if this is all it took to get semi-decent backup play, which is just go get a guy who's got, you know, a couple dozen NHL games under his belt, who's won some games and played with people who matter, like the, you know, the kind that come available every single July 1st. Why have we been wasting our time with, you know, the Curtis McElhaneys of the world and Henrik Karlsson, Leland Irving? What's been going on?
Well, those guys were all old regime guys.
Exactly. But even when the old regime had, honestly, the best results they had for a backup, Curtis Joseph and Vesa Toskala. And they're like, oh, well, this clearly works. So let's go right back to dealing with the unknowns that, frankly, as much as we bitch about the Flames playing with no confidence in front of backups, the backups never gave them a reason to feel confident other than they were present. and it's the nice thing to do.
Mm. And I think that's part of that nasty cycle, right? Of we can't get a backup because the backups don't play well and the team doesn't play well.
Exactly.
And I think right now they have no choice but to play well in front of McDonald because he's the starter.
Exactly. All right, I'm going to throw one more analogy out here, and then I think I'm going to be tapped for the night. What the Flames have been doing, essentially, since Brian Boucher left, breaking up with your girlfriend because she's a prude, but then the next girl you date is a virgin.
And the third fattest at the bar?
No. She could be hot. She could be a butterfish. She could be any. There's nothing wrong with her, but it's just what you actually are looking for from her. She's not in a hurry to give you. So what do you? Why are you barking up these same trees? Go out and find a chick with a lower back tattoo. Find a guy with 100 NHL games. That's what's gonna make you happy.
And maybe that's part of the learning here, right? Is we tried something different, we had good results. Let's keep trying something different.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I know that Feaster's been high on McDonald. Maybe it wasn't just that he was a guy with 100 games, but he was the right guy at the right time. And they had to take a chance. And it's like, oh, shit, Kipper's out. Let's just take this, you know, this guy who happened to come available, who we've liked for a little while, and has some NHL games because he needs to be the starter, not the backup.
When a GM or anyone in hockey says they're high on a player, does it not just, like, conjure up an image of the whole hockey ops staff, like, plugging that player into a vaporizer, throwing on some vinyl, and just, you know.
Well, you know, it's like Anthopoulos, the Jays general manager, he said of one of the Jays prospects that he's perhaps the best pitcher in the entire organization, and then, like, 3 months later, he was given away on waivers. So, you know, I think it's more to boost the player's self-esteem more than anything.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen that kind of thing in the NHL, too.
I'm very relationship-focused tonight. But, I mean, you're never gonna... You never say anything bad about your partner if you actually like them. Or even if you don't, just to be a good person. Be like, yeah, we claimed Joey McDonald off waivers. He's kind of chunky.
And
he's got a lazy eye. But what are you going to do?
It's the best we can do.
Yeah. I have no self-esteem.
He was free, you know?
Yeah, exactly. He was free. It was last call.
And, you know, like we said last week, you know, all three of our goaltenders, Irving, McDonald, and Taylor, are only 1 year. So, what have we got? We got a half season left to figure out if McDonald's a guy that we would want to bring back or not. And I think the answer to that is no if Ramo's coming over. But maybe we can make him look good enough that somebody else will sign him.
Yeah, or you can just make him, I don't know. You keep him, I'm so confused. This is so far away. We're dealing in hypotheticals. Too much.
We got to get some centers before we worry about the backup goalie.
Yep.
Yes. It's like...
And Matt, you were right earlier. Pyle Byron is listed as hurt, so that's why he's listed on both the Flames roster and the Abbotsford roster. So I don't know if he's been sent down or not, but he's listed as injured.
You can't send down an injured player. I don't believe, anyway.
No. That's why the Canadians bought out Gomez, because they didn't want him to get hurt so they could burn the buyout in the offseason.
I still find that funny every time somebody mentions buying out Gomez. It's like the Islanders putting DiPietro on waivers. Did they ever go through with that? I know there was talk
they
about
did.
It last...
They did.
Did they?
And shockingly, nobody claimed him and they sent him to the farm.
No, nobody claimed him, really? Of course nobody claimed him.
He's only got 8 years left.
Hey, Eric Cole was just traded, and he's got an 8-year contract, so they do move.
Eric Cole's got a 4-year contract.
Is it only four? I thought for some reason there's an 8-year deal.
Four. No,
it's four. It's going to be two in 2 months. So.
Yeah, he's in until 2015.
Yeah, no, Eric Cole just was considering stepping away from the game if the CBA didn't go his way.
Well, as we said last week, guys, if we need another forward, Dominic Moore is still out there. Maybe his magic can help boost this team.
Exactly. Maybe we should sign him. Could always use another second round pick.
There you go. Sign him and trade him.
Exactly.
All right. Well, any other topics you guys want to discuss for this week?
I'm good.
All right, well, let's wrap this show up then. As usual, I want to remind people that if you want more information, if you want to read some of the articles that are on the site, get more information about the show, or listen to any current or past shows, you can go to firesidechat.ca. We've got links to our Facebook, our Twitter, and our Google Plus page from there. Please follow us on any of those networks. The more people we get, the more and better conversation we can have. And if you're enjoying the show, make sure you subscribe. And the links are on the website on how you can subscribe through iTunes, through RSS, through whatever means you want to subscribe to the show. And tell your friends. If you're enjoying the show, tell people that you know, other Flames fans, to come have a listen to one episode. They're all less than an hour, so you can listen to them anytime. They're quick and easy to digest.
Like grapes.
Well, it depends which grapes. I find Don Cherry very hard to digest, but...
Well, he's very gamey. He's very old. You'd have sent him off to slaughter several years ago if he was actually fit for consumption. It's no one to blame but yourself if you're chowing down on grapes.
There we go. So the moral of the story is don't eat Don Cherry. He's not fit for consumption.
Exactly. He's more of a jerky.
Okay. Well, before we go too far down that road, I'm going to wrap this thing up. We'll talk to you guys next week.
Suck it, Tom.
Oh, we are the boys in chorus. We hope you like our show. We know you're rooting for us, but now we have to go.
Fireside Chat Podcast, produced and edited by Dan Stevenson. Theme music, Take the Lead, by Kevin MacLeod.